just stop that. Okay, okay. Hi everybody. Sorry I'm late. We had technical difficulties. The broadband has been playing up yet again. So hopefully it will last while while we're doing the webinar. So apologies. Today is the 4th of September 2017. I believe it's Labor Day over in the US. So happy Labor Day, if that's what you say. As usual, any questions or points you want to raise, issues, enhancements, then just ask away, really. That's really it. Have we got any questions or any challenges, any enhancements? I do believe one of the people here who doesn't normally get to attend is Dave Bratovich. I'm going to open his mic up and welcome him back. Hi, Dave. Can you hear us?
Long time no here.
How are you doing?
Oh, busy, busy, busy. But I was hoping that this was going to go on as scheduled because this is one of the rare times I'm not piling over tax issues right now.
That's right. Yeah, no, it's good to. Dave was definitely a regular on the Saturday webinars, but unfortunately, since we moved to a Monday, it just made it obviously more difficult for you to attend.
But I've been adopted by the Spanish guys.
I'm doing the Spanish webinar on the 23rd of this month. I'm not sure what I'm doing because I don't speak Spanish, but that's going
to
be interesting.
Well, you have to allow a little bit of translation time, so you kind of say it and then explain it to Roberto and Alejandro, and they translate it back. It works pretty good, but it just slows it down. That's all.
Well, that's fine. That's fine. More users, more questions, more ideas, the better.
Oh, they got some really neat things out there. They got a really nice project. I forget now who put that out there. I want to say, oh gosh, I'm drawing a blank on his name right now. I've only got to attend one and a half so far, and one as a presentator. So I'm a little rusty on their names. And most of the Argentina guys were not there yet.
Do we have any ideas or any questions? Roberto, Roberto's here. Hi, Roberto.
Sorry, I just got in and I overheard David say something about Argentina or something like that.
We were just discussing the Spanish webinar, and you've taught me into be attending on the 23rd, even though I don't speak Spanish.
It doesn't matter. We can translate on the fly, you know.
Works well.
Very
That's
good.
What we're good at. At least we've got people that can help you out that way.
So, do we have any ideas? There's not really much in the way of updates from me at the moment. Obviously, there's lots going on. If you haven't seen the announcement in the news groups of late, I'm now going to full-time for Niantis. I was originally still working part-time to fulfill a contract down in the centre of Nottingham in the UK. But by the time CIDC comes around, I will have finished that obligation and I'll be free, so to speak. So Niantis will be getting a lot more time dedicated to it, which is a good thing for everybody.
Yeah. I had a thing for you.
Oh, yes. Fire away.
I was trying to put a web browser in a docking pane, and I failed. I couldn't get it to work. And so I tried using the web browser example, and just adding the docking pane to it and then putting the web browser in the pane, and it doesn't seem to want to work.
Well, I can't do that.
I'm not sure you can get the handle of the web browser.
You can.
Maybe that's the problem.
It's doable.
Yeah, okay. Well, let's have a look. We'll take the suite controls.
I gave up using the CJ web browser and went with IE, but going back, I want to say 3 years ago, back in the, I'll say, Kojak 13s or 15 versions, I was putting a web browser in a docking pane.
Okay, I wanted to use the Kojak one because we figured out how to, you know, intercept the clicking on the hyperlink stuff and everything.
Yeah.
But I guess it wouldn't
Well, the thing
matter.
I found about the Kojak one is that they kind of stopped supporting it in the sense of adding and doing anything to it, and it was a little limited on capturing some of the events coming back I call it web events triggers that were going on that IE had a much better support. So I was using the IE. I use like six different web browsers in my Kendo UI.
Well, basically, for the docking panes, we need to be able to get to the handle. Now we can't get to the Kojak control doesn't provide a handle property, unfortunately. So we can see we can do it via the
Well, you put the clarion procedure. You use a windowed clarion procedure, and you put the docking pane, or the you fill the docking pane with that procedure, and you put the control web browser in the clarion
I don't think
procedure.
John's wanting to do that either, though, John. That'd be a bit of an overkill.
I'd prefer to be able to just drop the control on the same procedure if possible, but
Okay, let's take a
I could go the other way.
quick look at this. That's 16.31. We'll have them the same. It doesn't make any difference, but just to answer the question, we'll take a quick compile of that. And then what I was thinking is, with just one of the examples, we'll create two panes. One can just have a button on it, and one can have the okie dokie. Our theme this. Just bear with one second. This is the version 4 code coming back to bite me a little. So this is our version 4 template code. So it won't be a second. We've been moving some stuff to common class. In fact, remind me to talk about the common class later. Some changes I've done to it. So, but in the meantime, I'll just repair this quickly. Sorry about this. Should be one corrected. And the docking pane. At least you get to see there's lots of work going on. Oh, yeah, you don't need any of that. Quite a lot of tidy up to do with the themes, first and foremost, but also moving some of the code off to the common class as well makes it a little better. Okay, that should give us our compiled version. Sorry about that. So all I was thinking then to perform the test is it doesn't really matter. We'll go with that one, but we'll put two panes. That at the bottom, the browser at the top, if we can, of course. So we will want a docking pane on here. We're not bothered about that. We'll have two panes. At the moment, I'm not going to put any content in them. I'm just going to say that I want the two panes so I can just see them. So if we say, oh, top, bottom. On that one, I will actually put the button because it's a straightforward clarion. Now in window control, and it's going to be our close button. So basically, actually seeing the docking pane from there. Something, it's not like something there. Oh, I think I added the actual wrong. I added the wrong extension. Sorry, ignore everything I've just done there. That was completely wrong. Just getting ahead of myself. Right. Let's have the docking pane that way. Sorry about that. Same again. We'll have two panes, top and bottom. One for the top, one for the bottom, and on that one we will give it the button. Okay, so we can definitely see our panes, that's good. Can't get to them really, but there we go. So really we want that to be inside of there. Now we know we can't do it via the handle, so I'm just wondering whether just grabbing the actual clarion handle would bail us out. Be nice if it does.
Yeah. It's actually in the template where you can pick it, but that part doesn't work.
So let's just try the window and we'll just choose the OLE container itself. Okay. So yes, normally a lot of the controls, a really good chunk of the controls, do support a handle property. But as Dave said a minute ago, it's like they started this, they did so much to it, but then they've left it in limbo since. And I don't know what their actual plans are for it, but it's been a while since they've actually done any active development on the web browser part of it. Me personally, I do still use it, and I use it for using like HTML help and so on and so forth. It's brilliant for that. It's coming out of a table of my content control, and I get to load it straight via one of the method calls. I think it's set in a HTML, something like that, and I get exactly the results I want. They're not going off navigating to different web pages and so on and so forth, so it works well. It's going to come down to your requirements, really, but for what you're saying there, John, I mean, you're clearly just doing it that way.
Yeah, that's what I want to use it for, actually, is HTML help.
Yeah.
That'll work well. I mean, brilliantly. Real easy.
Yeah, it's I think I've shown you.
It's not very complex anyways.
the medical questionnaires that I've done in the past, I have them so they can do obviously different prompts per question, but they can actually do the HTML help for a particular question, and then I store that in the database, and when that question is being presented to the user, they've got a side panel which shows the HTML content, so of course I get to format it nice, just as I want it to look, and it's all within the control of, you know, of my content, if you will, so it works well.
Yeah, excellent. Yeah, I just made that change and it's working exactly the way I want it to now. Perfect.
Cool. Well, that's the end of webinar then. We'll cut 100% success. Right.
Bye, everybody.
We have got
to... So, Andy, is it possible to use like maybe a Chrome control instead of a...
I looked at that in the past. I think...
You know, since it's all open source and everything, you know, couldn't somebody just create something real easy?
Comes down to that, the golden question of getting the handle. I mean, the docking pane template does... No, it's not the docking pane. I think it's the common class, actually. Just let me have a quick look for you. Is there something about handle in the common class?
No, but I mean, instead of using the IE
Well,
or
as I say, it comes down
use
to
the Chrome.
You can actually get another application, so you could use technically you could dock Chrome, but you'd have to get the handle, the window handle to Chrome itself, rather than just the embedded part of it. I mean, if Chrome supports giving you the handle to the embedded editor or the embedded viewer, I should say, then brilliant. But if it doesn't, you could do it via getting the handle of the window title, and the Common class does include functions for that.
Yeah. Well, my question is, you know, everybody goes with IE. And so they've got the COM wrapper, and everybody uses the COM for IE and so on. But I haven't really seen anybody say, okay, here's a Firefox one, or here's a Chrome one, or here's an Opera one, or whatever.
Well, I know Firefox originally did have a COM wrapper for theirs, but they dropped support very early on. As far as I know, anyway, they dropped support for it. Because originally I was going to look at including support for it, but by the time I got to it, they'd already discontinued it. So it's kind of
Microsoft has dropped support for their COM for a long time, too.
Yeah, but it's an old version as well. They might have dropped support, but you can still get the COM wrapper to it. Whereas the others, they didn't. They dropped it.
So obviously, they didn't do anything for Edge and so on, you know, but there's nothing there.
But you could do it by the, like I say, getting the window title. It's a bit crude, but it would do it, as long as you can get the title, of course.
But then you have to install Chrome on your computer.
Of course.
But I was wondering if you could just, like, grab some of the components of it and use them or something like that.
I don't know. Oh, I'm going to say, David's got some questions, but David's actually, Mike, he just made a mention of that. Hi, David, your mic's open. I don't know if you...
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, sorry, I didn't realise. If anybody else wants the mic open, just raise your hands, not a problem. No problem whatsoever. Yeah, sorry. I know you've got some questions.
Well,
what were you saying about the
when you started talking about Chrome, I got very, very excited because that's something I would love to do inside of Clarion, because the IE control doesn't handle quite a lot of things that I want to do in HTML5 and stuff like that. Not necessarily doesn't handle it, but doesn't handle it as well as Chrome handles it and so on like that. And obviously the old IE control is getting very, very dated now. But there is a product called the Chromium Embedded Framework, CEF, which might be some possibility of being contained. But there is another product that I've been doing some looking at, and I've actually seen some applications developed in it, which are really powerful applications and run across both Macs and Windows, and that's a product called Electron. And this is actually the product that is used to develop Slack and also develop Visual Studio.
Oh, right, yeah.
And that actually has completely embedded inside it the full V8 Chrome engine. I don't know how they do it or anything like that. I'm not technical enough to know or understand anything about that, but one of you technical guys might be able to look at that particular product, Electron it's called.
And figure out what
they're doing, and sort it all out from there.
Worth a look. It won't be this side of the DEF CON, unfortunately.
No.
We're flat out on DEV at the moment. But like I say, more time when I get back. Happy to take a look. I use Slack myself. You're saying Slack's got the actual...
Well, Slack is built with a product called Electron, which is the same people that made the Atom editor.
Right.
If you know of that. Let me think. Just hang on a second. Let me just... I've got a browser link somewhere for it. Just give me one second. I've only got one screen here, so I'm having to shoot off onto something else here. Where's it gone? The script, have I got it in there?
Yeah, because what I was thinking, you know, what you really need is just the renderer. And so if you could just tap into the renderer part of it and just feed it HTML or JavaScript or whatever, You know, that's all you really need.
I think in theory that's all.
Yeah. But I haven't seen anybody really do any kind of work with the other browsers at all. They're just kind of stuck with Internet Explorer, and they're like, well, that's it. That's all I'm going to do.
I put a quick link in the chat there to Electron. That would give you a starting point for someone to look at, Andy, and see whether there's anything there that could be helpful to you.
Let me have a look. There's no Skype chat. Oh, in this chat here, sorry.
Yes, sorry, that's what I meant. In the webinar chat, not the Skype chat, yes.
Oh, I'll tell you what, we'll look at it in here. There you go.
Chromium embedded.
I've seen some very, very powerful applications being built with this. And as I say, Visual Studio itself is actually built with this.
Yeah. I mean, what we need is Andy to create us a template and some classes to work with that. You know, that's what I need, Andy.
That would be fantastic.
Yeah. Just leave it.
Come on, Andy. You've got all the time in the world now. Get to working on it.
Just trying to see. Okay. Yeah, that's Slack. I recognise the old thing. Okay, well, we shall take a look. Yeah, we shall take a look. Questions? Just going back to what we have. What have we got here?
I put one in there, Andy, for Pete. He was asking when you first put the when you got caught up on the webinars. He was looking for a demonstration of you doing a table to the report control, because I don't know if you recall, we finished one webinar and you ran out of time to do it for him, and you were going to do it in the following week.
We did,
and I don't think it ever got done.
Yep.
And he just was asking about it a few days ago on the Skype chat, so I put a question in there for him about it.
Yeah, I did see. I don't need to remember which webinar it was in there. We did where we did the actual training. But I better find it. I'll look towards the end of this, because that was more rather than question. I assume if we've got questions, mop them up first. If time permitted, yes, we'll go straight on to equivalent of a training. Because we did some, I think we did manual, and I think we did the browse enhance. I'm not quite sure what he means by table, though. Does he just want, because a browse enhance report control is obviously based upon a table, a list enhance is. Could be a table, could just be records you've loaded into the queue. So it's just, I could do with actually knowing what he means by getting the records from a table. Does he just mean he just wants to read them and manually add them himself? Could really do with maybe asking him in preparation for next week's webinar, and then we'll cover it at the training from there.
Yeah. Well, if he's online on the Skype chat, I'll ask him for you, Andy, during the next week.
Back
for next week for you.
Brilliant. Yes, thank you. Any other questions? Paul. Paul's got his hand up. Hi, Paul.
Yeah, hi, Andy. Hi.
Hi, how are you doing?
Some time ago, you demonstrated a direct report control directly connected to an MS SQL database.
That's right.
Using, I think, ADO, I don't remember now.
Yep, it was the data bank.
You were going to, or I had asked about a Postgres example. Do you have anything like that, or is there a place I can look up to find things like that?
I don't, because I don't actually have, I'm going to say I don't have a database, but I have just configured a new Linux server. Just looking at it, I'm not sure I've got the actual Postgres on there. But it'd be something that I could actually, not sure I could do quickly now, but I could do for next week if we wanted to cover it then. Unless you've got, do you know basically connection strings? I can take you through the basics that you'll need, but we might have to change the template to enable you to basically set the actual attributes and so on and so forth. I mean, basically,
yeah, I can get a connection string for you. Give me just a moment.
Yep, no problem. I'll bring in, while we're doing that, I'll just bring in the data bind.
Okay. Trying to think of the simplest way to get it to you here.
I think in this one, I just did some very simple ones of access, and basically, it's all revolves around getting the connection string and then passing it to ADL, or passing it to our template and class, which in turn will which establish the connection for you. I don't think I've got my MySQL. No, I was going to say I haven't got my MySQL database set up here.
Okay, I'm just going to the application which has this. Okay, so driver equals.
Let's just take fire up a notepad here. So something along the lines of, yep.
The driver equals PostgreSQL with a capital P, and then SQL is capitalized, space Unicode. That's the ODBC driver equals.
PostgreSQL.
So sort of PostgreSQL space Unicode.
Yep.
The server name is simply going to be either the name or the IP address.
So okay, for like so, yep.
And then the database name, that would be obvious, whatever testing,
yep.
Whatever you want to call it.
Something like that, yeah.
The UID equals is Postgres, and that's all capitals. Then there's the password equals.
Is it Postgres 1S or double S, is it? Let's try it.
Double S is it, PASSWORD. And then the port, which typically is 5432.
5432?
Correct. That's the default if you install it, either in Linux or in Windows.
Making the right thing of this, SQL. Okay. UID is which, sorry?
Postgres. And so up at the top where you have Postgres Unicode, there's a space between the PostgreSQL and the U.
Like so.
So it's two words. Like so, yes.
Okay.
And we're missing a password. Where does it? Just a moment, I'll tell you.
I was going to say, what about the username and password, which I'd probably expect to be around here.
Yeah. So ODBC driver equals server name equals database equals UID equals password. And then Postgres only has one S in the UID. Let me move this over here.
Okay, okay. Just having a look looking at our report control while we're at it for... Oh, not on there, though. Oh, it's as good as any. Just give me a second, just having a quick look. Come out of that. So, just doing a basically a search around to see what people are saying for. Yeah, okay, Connection Spring.
I have posted it in the question, Andy, if that helps you, what I have.
Okay, let's just take a quick look. Well, I'll store a note of this, set myself up. Yeah, I've got you. Test, Postgres, password. I'm not going to remember, I'm not going to forget that password in a hurry, are you? Now, we put it into the particular... Yeah, see, it's got it. Just looking at what people say here about getting the ADO record set, which is basically what this part here is, where he's talking to the raw ADO engine, setting these characteristics, what cursor type, where's he getting it from, the connection string, so on and so forth, and then going off and actually doing the queries against it, brings them results in, binds it straight, the actual ADO object binds it straight to the report control. So our main thing will be basically getting that connection string right. I'm just having a quick look online. Some people are saying it's along the lines of this, which is not a million miles off what you were saying.
It's the same. You need semicolons, obviously, between each part.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm going to... I'll have to set up a database on that, but that's not a problem. I've literally just, it was only the other day, configured a new Linux server for me here. So I'll just place it on there in for testing purposes. And if you're around next Monday, we'll have a go at doing that. Let me just send that myself.
I'll be here, yes.
Yeah, not a problem. I'm going to send myself an email on it, because I will forget. So, for Monday, there you go. Yep, no problem. And if we can put that support into the template, because I think we support, there are things in there at the moment. If we just take a quick look in the report control template for the binding, we've got MySQL in there, so it should build it in a particular format there. I'm trying to see where it does it. We have a calc driver string, so that would be in here. Yeah, you see here how we're calculating the driver string for them. So yeah, to be fair, Paul, it shouldn't be famous last words, but it shouldn't be too bad at all.
Okay, that's great. Thank you.
Let's see, the general idea. I mean, the template, looking at that there, let's just take a quick look at what we've got from the template point of view, just to see in the short term. We changed the MySQL one. This is, you know, it's a side copy anyway. But we can go on here, go to data source. Yep, that's no problem. The driver, if you go to other, I think it'll open it up. So you could start playing about that with that if you wanted to.
All right, I'll do that.
Server, database, UID, password. I'm not sure on the option, I'll be honest with you. Oh, well, I think that was MySQL, of course, yes. But, yeah, you could go with, where was your, go back to the template code. So the driver equals That's what it would be calculating. So yours would be along the lines of, and where's my example, which I just had?
Postgres UL Unicode.
Interesting. Somebody else same thing, but Postgres Unicode. So that would be your driver equals with the semicolon. And then you'll have your connection where you could actually specify your other options. So that would, you wouldn't need that bit. It's going to be a little difficult doing this in, blind with no database, but I'm just guessing at the moment. But it's going to be along the lines of your server. So on your example, I think you add
1.2.3.4 is fine. It's an IP address, right?
Yeah, something along the lines of that. Database test or whatever, you know. So that technically would be along the lines of what you need, and then your normal select statement. Of course, as per usual, all these can be overridden at runtime and so on and so forth. It's just if you specify in the template, you know, you've got other options. Put it into a variable, do none, and just do it yourself. You know, but just you could try those as a starting point. So you could go over driver equals. Remember the double curly brackets from Clarion's quirk, opening curly brackets, that is. But yes, that should technically be what you're after.
All right.
So I'm quite confident, I'll be honest, that would work for you. And all we'll be doing is just modding the template to support Postgres. If you've got any information about particular versions, although I don't think it'll make much of a difference. I mean, if you choose SQL, it doesn't really make, I think it gives you an option unless you choose a particular version. But from a template point of view, there's not really much. They're all really calculating to the same. I've just allowed for it should, you know, any in the future.
Yeah, no, I've used the 9.4, 9.5, and 9.6, and there's no ODBC chats with all of them. The Postgres ODBC driver chats with whatever it finds at that port. That's all it cares.
Yeah, exactly. So I think you'll be good to go. Where's Clarion gone? There we are. Going back to the other, driver equals Postgres SQL Unicode. Have your connection, like so. Have you got a copy of this app?
Of which app now?
This the DataBind example app.
No, I don't.
Ah. Oh, well, okay. Dare say you could do with that, to be fair. So let me zip this up and send it across to you on Skype, if that's okay.
Sure.
So you would be something along the lines of double that. Connect, I'll let you do them. So that's, we'll just rename that one. It's not Oracle. Don't think they'll thank me for that. Okay. Obviously, doing that a little blind because we got no database to test against. But I'll zip up that folder, and I'll fire it across to you as we speak, and then you can quickly report back if you like.
Oh, thank you.
Right, quick clean up on that. While that is zipping, have we got any other questions?
I have a question.
Yep, fire away.
Did you ever find the part 2 report demo with the XAML 2 to put in the demo application, the second procedure?
Yeah, I am tempted to say yes, I did. I didn't do to start with, and then you I think you sent it us back again. a second time, if memory serves.
Well, it's not been updated. But the demo app has not been updated.
No, it's been a while.
And then two is the current status of the command bar's mouse event pass through. Cross your fingers. Come on, Santa.
Not at the moment. The next updates are, sorry, just let me send this. The next updates are the version 4 theme.
I've been good all year.
I know, and you will get your thing.
I've only had one birthday.
You will get your thing, I promise. But no, it's not at the moment, I'm sorry.
And then the one that's been nagging me for a while is the reg-free version
of Durando. Yes.
Yes.
I can send you that afterwards. I've got a couple of things in mind. Which you've got some.
Well, the funny part is I created a manifest for it, dropped the version of Kojak in there, and of course, then I realized that, hey, it was compiled with Clarion 8 a long time ago.
Yep. No, this is C10. I take it you're in C10.
Yes.
Yep. This is C10, and it's, you don't have to take the word for it, but yes, it's this is Reg Recom.
Okay.
So there was some changes on it. So I'm not sure. Have you got inline filters on your version?
I don't recall off the top of my head.
Okay.
No, it would not be, because we're going back to Clarion 8.
Yeah, quite a while ago. I won't go into that. Yes. I don't know.
And just for a notice that we will have to have a conversation on is that I'm creating a comm control button replacement that goes beyond what Kojak's doing. I mean, you get truly flat buttons, multiple images on a button, drag and drop. It's going to have a slew of more feature set combination type thing so that you can emulate the full, I'll call it the flat Windows interface look.
Oh, okay.
And what I want to do is tie that into doing a template that replaces an app's all the buttons in an app at one time, kind of what you do with the other controls.
Yeah, the enhancers. Like the here's one I prepared earlier. If we go back to the suite controls, the starting point for that would be, if we just run this, that we have a date time picker, if anyone remembers it. They are manually added to the screen, but on the second example, that screen actually has 18 standard Clarion dates and 8 Clarion times, and then different variations. But all that screen definition is just standard Clarion entries. And then basically you attach the enhancer and you say go and enhance everything you find. So it's along the you're after something like that.
Right, right.
Yeah.
It would be just basically you drop it in, set and then have a color override for each procedure, that kind of a thing.
Yeah, so this is that procedure I just mentioned a minute ago. And you can see here that, it's going to go with the default interface. It picks up the settings from the actual picture you're using. Yeah, but that takes a load of standard Clarion entries and enhances them. So that'll be a starting point. But yes, that'll be a conversation that we'll have a look at together.
Yeah, I'm looking, and if that works well, then I'm going to consider redoing doing a replacement for the property grid to support time and drag and drop and a few other little things that the Kojak one's missing.
We've added some time to the property grid.
Well, I'm talking about the full date and time that you see when you want to do clock payroll management. It's weak.
Well, I was going to say, because we've added support. The property grid doesn't support time fields, but we do. And we use the mask to make it work, basically.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And it's real weak on images.
Could be a lot of work to overbring you, but, you know, yeah, fine. If you want to go down that path, it's just, you must be a glutton for punishment.
Well, I'm trying to figure out a way to decipher some of the things that are broken with Clarion and trying to understand how it's broken, and I figure the best way to understand it is start creating it and building it myself so I can see the internal workings, then I can try to figure out what's breaking the comms that are not loading.
Right. Well, I've got your thing. We will speak near the time, but at the if I can get the ear of Bob Z at the DEF CON, I will have a word, of course. No problem.
Yeah, that's one that's been frustrating for a long time.
Have we
the manifests are perfect. The manifests are perfect, but Clarion does not load the control. So it's not the control's fault, and it's not the manifest's fault. It's just something quirky, and you can't find it.
But it's not on all products.
It's only no, on the biggest one was Tracker. I had the guys from Tracker. I had some Clarion developers that were third party coming in. We're all pounding our heads trying to figure out why it doesn't work, and we can't get under the hood to really see it. But the manifests are perfect, and it works in every other, from VB to pick a flavor. It all works in every other language but Clarion. The closest you get is would be an icon inside the OLE container, and that's it.
Is that the tracker?
And no errors.
Hang on, is that the tracker? Which tracker is that?
The PDF
viewer control or creator.
Both of them.
Our PDF, we support the. Oh, not Reg Free Com. No.
But yeah, but that's the problem. Reg Free, it doesn't work.
Yeah.
And they ship their own. Manifest comes with it, and it works in every other language. And then I created one using my tool, and it's basically identical. Doesn't work, and it does not issue any side-by-side errors. As far as everything's concerned, it's a perfectly loaded manifest and proper manifest, and it loads properly. It just doesn't display inside Clarion's app. Run it outside of Reg Free, and it works fine.
Yeah, I was going to say, because we support it in the PDF wrapper. But
and John had the same problem with some shipping controls. The whole slew of like 15 or 16 different controls, none of them work with Clarion, Reg Free.
Definitely a competition.
I haven't found any, but and the other issue would be is the OLE directory refuses to show some comm servers out there.
My guessing is that part is old technology just been bolted into the IDE.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, that method needs to be updated in the runtime library, but it's trying to find out why it's skipping it so that it can report it to him. Because I've reported it to them before, and it's no progress. So it's like, if I can just give them a nudge, nudge, wink, wink, this is your problem, maybe I can get it fixed. I know it's not H5, but...
in fairness to them,
broken for a while.
They asked about the Reg Free, created the VB example and passed it to them, and true to word, they did actually come up with it. You know, it's made things so much easier for us. We'll try with this as well. So, have we got any other questions or ideas for the toolset? No. Could be a quiet one, this one.
Come on, Dave. You got lots of questions.
Ah, Dave Patterson. Sorry, just saw that come up. Didn't see that a second ago, unless you just typed it. Hi, David. How are you doing?
Hey, are you good?
Good, good. Can you give a brief overview of the syntax editor? Of course.
Over. Kind of looking to do with that is using it like a virtual notepad. So, you know, instead of having one large document, have it page loaded, you know, like a record based. Do you know what I mean?
No, just expand a little.
Like a word processor or a note, you know, a large notepad, if you were adding text to it and then you wanted the users to be able to edit it, you know, you'd bring in the whole thing. Okay. The whole document, you know, all at once, and take them to the bottom of it.
Yeah, you have to bring in the whole thing anyways.
You do, okay.
You kind of send it to the comm.
The only thing you'd have there is, I like it. I do use it, but it doesn't support word wrap. So, from an editor point of view, from an end user's editor point of view, it's not really friendly like that. If you were setting content and putting it in there, of course you're in charge of that content. You can then put the couch returns in and so on, and yeah, it'd be fine. But as a word processor type interface, no, there's better.
Not the way to go.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I mean, of course, I can take you through it, and you know that's not a problem. And you've got loads of methods there to let you manipulate the content and so on and so forth, and print. I mean, we use it on some of ours for letting them set the font, the size, the colour, so on and so forth. It's pretty good from that point of view. But yeah, I think from an actual editor point of view, there's no word wrap, and that's just
that's
a bit of a shame.
Yeah, that's a problem. Yeah.
So, okay. But actually, it's a bit of an overkill. I was going to say you've got is Word using Word out of the question, or is that a bit of an overkill?
Well, yeah, probably overkill. Yeah.
Yeah.
They're mainly looking for more of the notepad, but maybe with some color and some basic. You know, we've done it with RTFs, but it's very difficult to manage the RTFs, you know, to actually manipulate them.
Yep.
The way that we'd really want to. And so we're always kind of looking for a replacement for that. And so I thought, I wonder if the syntax editor would do it, but obviously just without word wrapping, that's a problem.
I was going to say, you've got to highlight the word wrapping to start with, unfortunately. And to try and, I mean, you can intercept the keystrokes and you could try and emulate word wrapping yourself, but I think that would be a whole world of pain.
Yeah.
Challenging, you know, yeah. To be fair.
Mainly that. Just really, it's just a large, you know, set of notes, you know, field notes or, you know, case notes or client notes, that type of thing, but they're perpetual.
Right.
You know, so they can go on for years and years and, you know, hundreds of pages of notes, but you don't want to like load that up every time someone wants to edit it. They just want to be able to look at the last and then be able to scroll back, you know, look at prior stuff, but mainly they're just looking at.
Well, I can give you an idea of how we've done it on one of our apps. Well, actually it's for the practice management system, which I've worked on in the past. And imagine if you will, you've got lots of, you know, lots of notes. It's for dentists and you've been to the dentist.
Yeah, it'd be that,
over.
That
type. Yeah, you've been to the dentist numerous times. You've got an added level of, I won't say complexity, but legislation to adhere to in that these are medical notes. So medical legally, you're not allowed to actually go and edit those notes. You can't go back in time and just go and erase the fact that you give somebody an anaesthetic just because they had a reaction. There's rules about that. So the way we've done that is we present them in a report control. So you've got all the separate notes. From the table point of view, basically you've got all the separate notes. They have a parentage, so you can see that, imagine there's no revisions. You've got note 1, then note 2, then note 3, then note 4, and date and time of the note, who created it, who they're creating them on behalf of, that type of thing, and so on and so forth, with different attributes. So that person's notes should be coloured in red, so you can scan down the notes and see who created that note or who's it on behalf of, that type of thing. So you can use the power of the report control to do that, and then the revisions give a little indicator to the left, and then we use the tree structure so that you're looking at the very latest notes, but if you say show the revisions, then you get the plus at the side, you click on the plus and you get to see the original note underneath it showing that they typed in same with it, if it was deleted. So if you look at them, you want to look at just somebody's notes, that's it. You're looking at 1, 2, 3, 4 or 1, 2, 4 of 3's been deleted. But they can click on certain options to have a look at revisions and deletions, and then it shows chronologically what was there with the ability to fold them down in a tree structure. So
yeah, that sounds pretty interesting.
Yeah, and the word wrap, of course, we know the report control from, I think you was present, not last week because it was a public holiday, but the week before, John's challenge was the word wrap as we went into the report control. But from a visual point of view, just painting them, it supports the word wrap brilliantly for you. So that could be a way to go for.
Yeah, do you have a sample? Can you show
a? I can't on this machine. It's
oh, okay.
Their particular.
I'm just curious. Particular.
I will see if I can knock a similar example together for you. But I'm just trying to think. I tell you what, I'll see if I can get you some screenshots. In fact, I'll see if I can get some screenshots here. Just one second, where I'm not breaking any
rules. John share his.
Yeah, but John's weren't.
Weren't they multi-line wrapping and so on for the report control?
Can't remember, to be fair.
I think that's what he was asking for.
It was, but did he get a solution to that? Was it?
Well, we got so far, but then we ran into. Let's have a look at the last webinar. We got so far. Would be.
At least I saw the wrapping, and that was pretty cool.
We got the wrapping because that was no problem.
And the multi-line, which was anything. Anytime I wanted to edit. Report control cell, it would expand it onto one line only. And I thought it was cool that you could get it to so that it did the multi-line.
Okay. Well, I think it was in here. David, I will try and get you a couple of screenshots, if nothing else, to just paint the idea of how that thing works.
Okay. Yeah, that'd be great.
Just see if I can... Yeah, I've got something here. Might just be able to help.
Are you talking about text editors, Andy? I've got a sort of requirement for that coming up sometime soon where I need some sort of text editor where I can have like tokens inside the text and do a right click and have some selections from a right click menu that can replace the token. Okay. Is there a text editor that would do that sort of thing?
It comes down to this, do you want the word wrapping and so on? You know, that's the thing, because these are text.
I would want the word wrapping inside once the token has been replaced, because the token might get replaced with one word, 20 words, 200 words, something like that. So the whole thing would have to rewrap after the token had been replaced.
Yeah, you see, I think the syntax editor is great, but it's more, I use TextPad all the time, and I happen to know that TextPad is built with the CodeJock controls, because I've run WinID on the actual TextPad elements, but there's no word wrapping on that, although I think they might have implemented their own word wrapping.
Is WordPad an option for this? The inbuilt WordPad inside Windows?
We'll get the handle of it and put it in.
But then you're going to have to try and build it. Well, certainly for my application, I have to try and then build in the right click and some other, putting all my choices on the menus.
Yeah, I think you're going to.
Probably isn't an option, really.
Yeah. Not really. No, it's going to be the word wrap was going to be the killer of the syntax editor, which is a shame. I mean, we'll have a look and see if the new one has word wrap facilities, but I just don't think so. Okay. David, going back to, I've just had a quick look on this machine here, and there are no screenshots, so I will get you some screenshots for next week. That's no problem, just to demonstrate the idea. But imagine if you will, you've got this list. I can't remember where we did it in here with the edit in place. But it was definitely, if it weren't that one, it must have been the week before. But basically, you could use word wrap and so on and so forth. The only problem you would have is the only problem you would have is the syntax editor just wants to be normal code, no strike through, bold, so on and so forth, because you're going to be displaying it in a report control, which is, again, it's not RTF, it's not HTML, unless, of course, Dave's here, you could use XAML. So, you know, that would be another option to you, but you start getting a bit more complicated, but that would do it for you as well. But it's just how complicated you want to get with it and how the word wrap would work. I think that would work okay, though. Dave does quite a lot with XAML.
Word wrap's no problem. You could actually have a cell for viewing that scrolls.
Right.
And see your, you know, paragraph upon paragraph. Lots of different things. It's just depending on how much effort you want to put in and what you really want it to do. It's not necessarily going to do every single thing.
This was the example. It was just the colouring what threw me, but yes, we applied skin to it afterwards. But yes, this was the example where you got word wrap and you go into it.
And we see, here's an example. Do you need to edit in place? If you don't need to edit in place, then you can use XAML and do anything you want, but you're going to bring it up into a editing field box of some sort, whatever. Choose your container of choice in the form that you're going to bring up.
Like on a separate form? Yeah, okay.
Yes, if you brought it up in a separate form. So if you wanted to use XAML in your cell, you could pretty it any way you want, display it any way you want, but it's not going to be allowed to be touched and edited, because when you bring it up, it's just going to want to change it to XAML formatting, and you're going to get all the tags and everything, and it's just going to look ugly.
You'd need the equivalent of a XAML editor.
Confused. Yeah. So the other thing would be is that's a visual presentation of the contents of your cell, and you're not going to use edit in place. Now, you can work around it, which Roberto and I were doing, where you could click on it and take the XAML, translate it back, strip it, then do the edit, then translate it back into XAML, and that's just a whole lot of work.
Yeah.
I was going to say, I'm not sure how much World of Pain. I think there's workarounds, which we did. And
it's different if it's only one or two options kind of a thing. But when you got a paragraph of text, it's not worth the effort. Mm-hmm. Now, if you were to take that XAML and load it into the text editor and your people knew XAML, then you could have color-coded and syntax editing and all that nice stuff. And you know, as long as everybody knows and speaks the same language. But
they probably don't know XAML, though. I don't.
No, geez, no.
Highly unlikely. But...
You're great if you sell me to Dave.
You could be surprised.
Come to the dark side.
He's using the web browser option for...
That's what I was just thinking. Maybe an HTML.
Oh, yeah, there's a lot of different things. If you have a handle to the control, you can stuff it in that cell. So there's a lot of different things you can do. Depends.
You could use the HTML editor.
Exactly. But the thing is do you want to use edit in place, or do you want to bring up a form? So it's just the mechanics of figuring out how you want to use it, and then you got to figure out what tool is going to fit.
Mainly not necessarily as a form, but as a, like I said, as a notepad. You know, so it would open up to them with the last... you know, at the last note, and then they could page back, you know, page forward, you know, go to the top, go to the bottom, that kind of thing, and then be able to insert into the middle of that.
Yeah, we let them do that. Well, we don't let them insert in the middle because they only from the application point of view, they have to be chronological. Of course, yours would be different, but on that, the requirements on ours, they had to be chronological. But you could go and edit. They might be that they've just... they're doing such an the person's within last week, they've come back in this week, and they've put it on the upper left 7.2, and all of a sudden they go, it's not upper left 7, it's upper left 6, and I've put my notes wrong from last week. So they can go to last week's note, which might not be the latest. They might have gone and seen a hygienist afterwards and had other work done, and so on and so forth. So they can go and edit, double click on a previous note. It just opens it up into a window in a simple text editor, lets them change their notes. They in there they can merge tokens and add quick tasks and quick words and so on and so forth, and quick phrases. But then it gets saved back, and that's where the revision history comes in, where you see the very latest, but you get to fold down the original. So it works. It sounds very complicated, but it works really well for them. You know,
I think that difference probably is, though. I mean, the one would be the using the edit in place, you know, for individual notes, and I'm kind of looking more at just a perpetual note, you know, one long, you know, note, kind of like you're saying, though, for, you know, for a patient, but not in any, you know, not date or time, or, you know, time stamped, only within that perpetual note, that kind of thing. You know, it's all just one big.
So it's one big long thing itself. Yeah. Oof. Yeah. Yeah.
What two things real quick, those that are considering using the syntax editor for any reason, when you first load it up, and let's say you're going to allow the syntax class you're going to use is JavaScript. You want to display JavaScript files, And when you first bring it up, there is no file loaded. If you were to type in the editor, which would work fine, you would not get your syntax coloring because no file was loaded with the proper extension. So what you have to do is create a dummy file with 0 bytes, but the proper extension, .js, you would load that. And from that point on, you, whatever you typed in would adopt that class JS color syntax. So from the user's standpoint, as they're typing it, they would get the colorization kicked in. And the other thing you have to remember with the syntax editor, there's no way to close your document. So if you have an outside source, let's say you edit a file and you have another outside process going on to touch that file, you'll get possibly access denied errors because the syntax editor is still going to have it open. So what then you have to do is actually load a different document so that it closes the previous one. Tools of the trade, trip.
Yeah, little tricks of the trade, yeah.
Yeah, it's just that can cause a lot of frustration, and I was having problems with loading bank files, ACH bank files, and I had another process kicking off, and it was not working because the syntax editor was still had the file open.
Yeah. No, thanks.
And that was only for viewing it. It wasn't for editing.
I know that I was just having a look if they had added any kind of word wrap and so on and so forth, but it looks like they haven't, unfortunately. So yeah, bit of a shame.
No, that's been out on the user group posting in the forums, people asking for that, and it's still hadn't got a response. It's been a while.
Yeah, shame really, but never mind. I'm trying to think of a solution for you there, David, but yes.
Kind of a tough one.
Yeah, it is. I'll still grab them screenshots. Let you take a look. If nothing else, might prove the prove some ideas for you.
Can I give a possible solution to you?
Ooh, yes.
Sounds weird, right? But it's something I've done before. If you use the web browser, there's a way in HTML to make content editable. It's actually a data attribute in HTML, content editable. So you can actually just like double click on a paragraph and change the text within it. And you should be able to, in the web browser, I would imagine, turn that particular attribute on and off. And that might give you like all the old records, leave them as non-editable, and just the final sort of paragraph or div, whatever it happens to be in the HTML editor, make that into content editable. I've got something running doing sort of something along those lines, but using the File Explorer control from Capesoft.
That's kind of
I would like to sort of try and do that in the CodeJuck web browser, which is why I was quite interested in the answer to John's original question. So that might be some sort of possibility for you, David.
Yeah, okay, thanks. Yeah, HTML does sound kind of like maybe the easier answer. At least it's more definable than the RTF
stuff
that we're messing with.
Yeah, it is, and I think you can get to the editor. So looking at ours, obviously there's other flavors available, but I know you can get to the editor and place it in panes and so on and so forth, and you can get to the actual raw content, both HTML content, and you know you want to store that. So your thing is this. This is normal. This is old. You get the idea.
Mm-hmm.
So you can. I think the editor I use, I store them. You know, we were saying before about I use this when they are setting up their questions. So they have the editor, and then I use the other one to just view it. Work well.
Now, Andy, do you have that as a edit in place inside of report control?
No. No.
And Dave, what was your plan? Were you going to do edit in place or bring up a form?
Probably a form, or at least a form with a big text box, like probably the top of this window would be what they would see.
Okay, The other thing is you have a collection of note records, and you're going to load them all into this, or you're going to have a free form one giant note.
No, it'd be just, you know, the last note being displayed here, and then when they paged up, I would get the prior.
Okay.
You know, the prior record.
This should work well then.
And then, you know, as they that's kind of a little challenge here is like when they fill this up, you know, when do you break to another record, that type of thing?
Yeah.
The pagination, that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Well, when you said page up, I thought, well, that's okay saying that, because are you going to let them scroll? Because you're going to have to know basically how many records and what size of the content is in those records as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're going to have to put something like a character counter so that they know they're getting close to the end of a record. You don't want them to stop in the middle of a word and then forget to put the hyphen in.
We'd want to treat it to them. You know, they want to see it just as, to them, it should look like just one long, one big document.
Yeah. Yeah.
Really just, that's what I'm kind of trying to emulate, so that they would think that they did load in every single page. You know, this is just one gigantic document. They can scroll and move around just as, like, you know, just one big Word doc.
I think you
they just happen to be adding stuff to the end of it.
Okay, how many characters are you, do you have in a note record?
Well, that's
just
a good
ballpark. Just
that's
ballpark.
A good question.
If you think you're going to store HTML, that's kind of irrelevant.
It's really, it really be per page. You know, that's kind of the.
Yeah. Do you know what about
what's being displayed?
What about the HTML? But putting in. So imagine this is one record, another record, and so on and so forth. Record free, that type of thing. Oh, still in bold. But you get the idea. Mm-hmm. Now, putting this into a table, but no...
Yeah.
You know,
build a table structure and have the HTML hold all your records.
Yeah, so if you know
and
you...
And then when you insert a new record, you're just putting a new header table in, and then you parse the table to write it back out.
Yeah, you don't want to visually see the table, as in lines and so on and so forth, unless, of course, you want to. But you could just, you know, no particular visual table, but just have it so that you know, okay, I'm this particular customer or whatever, I've got 15 records, so I'm going to need a table of two cells wide by 15 rows. The second cell could be your record ID, so you know when they're in that particular row. Ah, that's the record I've got to go and, you know, bring up and let them edit if you want to, and so on and so forth. So use a table attribute, have a hidden hidden column, which has got your row ID. So visually, you're just looking at paragraphs of information.
Or it could be date timestamps or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We've done something...
Or just a simple line break.
Well, again, it's in the other system. I will get you a screenshot of that. But basically, we used the Kojok web control, and you created a – imagine you had a whole analysis center, and you could pre-configure all the options to all the different reports that you wanted to run. So person A goes in, they're more interested in the patient, basically how long a patient had been waiting and that type of thing, and so on and so forth. Patient user B might not be interested in that, but they're interested in the type of treatments and so on and so forth. So you configure these particular options what you want, and you just go into the reporting center, in the analysis center, and you say, right, prepare it for me, please. It goes off, it finds all the it charts them as well. So basically it creates charts, creates everything it needs to, and then basically builds the whole lot as one big HTML document, but it's all sectioned and so on and so forth. So you've got all the links at the top and you can jump around. And we use that. And that, again, that's really well received.
And you build the links into the document?
Yeah.
So you can go around, yeah. Huh.
So, but that's using a combination of tables, external images. So we cut all the graphs first. So we've got a hidden chart control. We build all the charts that we need, save the image, and then insert them into the HTML. So, and the idea is, because some of these things, it's a lot of number crunching. It's something that they'll do, you know, they'll log in the morning, run, because you store these setups as like predefined templates, if you will. You go and go, okay, run my month-end analysis, and they'll go off and make a cuppa, come back, and hey presto, they've got a report waiting for them, but it's all there. And I think it save the HTML, so it actually saves it as a page should they want to view it externally, and it cuts it to a PDF as well.
Do you get, like, even on this little editor here, are these line, like...
Ignore the thing underneath. That was just for demonstration purposes. But if you put a table in...
Yeah, can you actually grab each of those lines, or are they, like, HTML paragraphs, or are they...
It's however you want to set it up. I think they're in as breaks, aren't they? Yeah, they are. They're in as breaks. But you can put paragraphs in. You can put CSS formatting in and so on as well.
I gotcha.
So I think you can right-click on here and apply a style to it. I'm not sure what we've got. Oh, there's a style. It's a while since I've done this example. But if we have a look at the code now, then you can see it's got the style sheet linked in and so on and so forth. And there's your paragraph there, so you can see.
I just wonder, I'm wondering how you would break that into records, you know what I mean? So that these were three. Well, in this case, it'd be a line, a blank, another line, a blank, you know, another line, so five records, I guess.
No, not at all. You could do them as paragraphs and set your style sheet to give you a bit of padding around your paragraphs. If you want to, like so, you could have them as a table and just have a bit of padding again on there. You might want the table only from the point of view of, I mean, it depends. If they edit, would you want to be able to double-click on that? Oh, sorry, just double-click on that and bring open a window with just that particular element in.
No, you'd want to just be able to edit that right there.
Just edit that right there, like so. Yep. Oh, we don't need the table then. No, just read your records and build your content dynamically. Really simple then. Much more, don't bother with the table. Just read your records and build the content, probably put it in paragraphs or divs.
So the records would be each div? Is that the...
Yeah, you could do it that way. And use CSS to format it to whatever particular visual style you want.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I'll give it a shot. Maybe I think that's probably a good way to go.
Yeah, and of course, beauty of that is you do get to let them put whatever they want in. So, you know, okay, I need that, and I want to put a thing in. It depends if they wanted images, but you've opened up so much power to them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's just being able to, like I said, being able to make that look like it's a virtual page, you know, like it's just one big,
yeah,
one big document, not a bunch of separate.
No, you know, I think
that's a bunch of separate records.
The best way of going in, if you cut them into each particular div, then you could know basically from the way I'd probably do it, just from a trace point of view, is. Load your records into a queue and then build it from there, so you know, right, the fourth entry in the queue is the fourth div, which happened to be linked to record 1, 2, 3, that type of thing. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. But that's your that's your loading and saving mechanism outside of that, behind the scenes.
And you can trap page up and page down.
Well, it's the editor, does it all. And it doesn't have to be that editor, I mean... You know, you can save all this and then show it in the Kojak web browser, because it's just HTML.
Oh, yeah, I got you, okay.
Yeah, the thing I was mentioning before is, I think I do it in this one. Might prove myself wrong here. Just let me come out of that. It comes back to them questionnaires, but... We're in here. You set up a form. Oh, that's a grid. Let's not do that one. Doesn't really matter. But we've got a question here. And I can say, okay, I want the help text. So I can say, this is some help. Helps if I spell it right, of course. And I think I'll let them have a tooltip as well. So So they can set up their own questions, and if they're ever using that particular form, I'll just take this out here because I'm not sure what data I've got loaded. That won't be a second. Yep, okay. So now there's me going to that form. And we'll bring up a new form. That one which I had a minute ago. And if I go on to the question, you can see here that'd be HTML, and the tooltip should. The one there, the tooltip should kick in. Oh, I think that's actually on the finger. Oh, it's there. There's the tooltip down there. Okay, maybe it's in grid mode, because there's two ways of doing it. You can do it in property grid, or you can do it in like a data grid, which uses the report control, and the tooltips kick in that way. So you've got a couple of options when you set these up. But yeah, that is using the HTML editor for your entry of the HTML, but it's using the CodeJock viewer for the viewing of it. No point in
they're different. There's the CodeJock viewer versus the editor.
The editor is edited by NBIT. It's a completely different company, a completely different control. So, but
oh, that's the editor. I gotcha. Okay.
Yeah.
And then this is the viewer part. Okay.
Viewer. Now you can use the editor in view mode, but it was a bit. I want something very lightweight. I just want some HTML code which I've got in my record. I just want to load it in and put it onto the screen. And I don't want to instantiate a whole editor and then turn off 99% of its features to put it in view-only mode. It didn't seem the right tool for the job. So the editor is the editor, the viewer is the viewer, and everyone's the winner.
Okay. I mean, I think it's mainly trying to get the editor to see if I can get it to kind of simulate that. But I think in the editor, I think that would be the question. In that editor, I can trap the keystrokes.
Let me just crack it open and we'll have a look. Because it's a while since I did that.
Yes, you did.
Now I think we've got back up to there. I thought I just copied that in. I didn't copy it into this week's. Yes, I did. There we go. We'll open that up. We'll have a quick look. And while that's opening, we'll open the actual raw control up as well. So we would want to know about the keystrokes. Now, is it any particular thing? I know we can...
Like, trying to trap page up, page down, or I guess, probably want to have a couple special keys to be able to, like, date stamp or put in the person's initials in a date stamp, that kind of thing.
Yeah, I'm just having a look. If there's anything on there, there's a mouse click. Spell check. Oh, that was a nice thing. If you've got Word, it does use Office spell check, but if you've got spell check, it does.
That's pretty nice.
But I'm not seeing as you're typing. Image, document click, navigation. Oh, ask your key press. Yes, you can definitely. Okay. Oh, hang on. Of course you can, because I had to. There was some question mark regarding the backspace and the del key. So yes, I had to trap it. So yeah, it's coming back to me now.
Okay. But that'd be important.
If we said we wanted to just test page up, let's just try it. We'll try it on that blank editor. Okay. Events, we'll listen for that event. Not that one. Thinking about it, not that one. Crack cracking up here. Oh, there it is. Where's mine? Where's my code gone? Do you know what? We might have to do it because we want to get to the parameters. We might have to do it the old-fashioned way, but that's no problem. Ignore that a second, and we'll go to the event func. So that's not quite the thing we want. Something along the lines of that, a bit crude, but and it was reference one. I think it was the first parameter it passed it. Yeah, the key code. Okay, is it page down key, I suppose, then?
Probably, or maybe, yeah.
Or key page down. It's going to be one or the other. Yep. So it's a blank editor. So I'll just do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and I've got settings to do with the thing. So if I do page down, okay. If that's the case, let's message out that.
I think you got that change wrong, is that right?
No, I'm going to add it in a second. Do you know what? That'll do. Just make sure it's actually bringing us that back. Pull that down and put that on. Oh, sorry, yeah. I thought you... Yes, yeah, I got it wrong. I thought you meant because I'd not defined the thing yet. Not because I just can't type.
Yeah. I don't know, maybe he's got a special function there to do something.
No, that's not the ASCII key press. I'm going to crack the class open and have a look, because I definitely... Oh, wrong product. Yeah, I'm trapping ASCII key presser, but ASCII key press, it's the same code as I have on mine. So when I run it, just out of interest, I have some code. If I do Control A, yeah, it's, and I've got copy and paste, and that is all going under my stuff. So. There's the actual editor code, and I'm trapping the exact same thing there, and you know, working accordingly on it. So not quite sure why that's not actually doing what I'd expect. But you can definitely trap the keystrokes because I do it. That does not really up. No, I'd have to have a look. But yes, you can drop the keystrokes. So you're thinking you would only load as and when you're doing the page up. That would give you a problem of your the scroll bar.
Probably arrows also, up, down arrows. Mm. If you hit the bottom, you'd want to load, keep going.
Yes, I've got you. Yep. I mean, are you talking a lot of records? Because, I mean...
Yes.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
so you wouldn't want to.
Fair enough.
Yeah, yeah. Because they're years worth, so there could be thousands. And even for right now, they've got, probably several thousand pages.
Yep.
And the page would be a full screen at a time. So if I broke that into records, it'd be, probably 20,000 and 30,000 records. So you wouldn't want to load them all the time. You're just loading that, just that sliding view of it.
Yeah, I've got you. Yeah,
like a browse.
Yeah. And you're looking at one portion at any one time. I've got you.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, once they're loaded, you could I'd probably still bang them into a queue and just keep repainting.
That's what I'm thinking. Update that and refresh it as you
on the
page down or page up and down. Yeah.
And then that way, once they're loaded, you've already got that record loaded. You can skip it, so it will get faster the more that they page up and down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay.
So, just an idea.
I don't know.
That's the whole point.
See what I can get there.
So, okay.
Thanks, Andy. Appreciate it.
No problem. Right, if we are more or less there, I just wondered how Paul had gone, if he'd managed to get a connection. But he's not... It might not be.
Not yet, Andy.
No, okay. Just curiosity.
I tried once, and then I was listening to you guys. So if I get one, I will send you off a Skype note.
Okay, okay. And in the meantime, like I say, well, if nothing else, I'll set up a database ready for next week, and an actual database engine and a database ready for next week, and then we can always do the mods there and then.
I did have a quick question, Eddie. Were you doing something with the Google Calendar and the calendar?
Yes, a lot.
Okay.
A lot.
I got you confused with Bruce. I was thinking Bruce was doing that with his net talk, and I asked him, and he goes, no, I'm not doing anything. I thought, oh, it must have been Andy that was.
Yes. Yes. In fact, I'll tell you what, we'll end. It's coming up, so we will end the webinar, and then we'll think it's all Don't necessarily have to go anywhere, but yes, we'll stop the webinar, and thank you everybody for attending. Hope you enjoyed. So that's